Okay, for this example, we're going to try to integrate x cubed minus 2x squared plus 5 divided by x minus 1. You start thinking through what techniques might be good to help you integrate this. We know a number of integration techniques up to this point. I don't think U substitution would really be the best choice. There's really no composition, no layers, no good choices for U. I don't see one thing being the derivative of something else to where you could fashion like a UDU type of setup. Whenever we see fractions, one thing that immediately comes to mind is the log rule, where you have the derivative of the denominator over the denominator. And this one has a strange property that the numerator's degree is higher than the denominator's degree. And so that could never be the log rule, because the derivative of the denominator, assuming you have a polynomial, will be smaller degree than whatever that polynomial's degree is. So the derivative of a linear expression will be a constant, not cubic. That's bigger. So whenever you have this situation or this setup where you have a polynomial of larger degree divided by a polynomial of smaller degree, the trick or technique you're going to have to use is called long division. Now, you hear the word long division, your mind immediately goes back to middle school or elementary school. It's very similar to how you would do long division with numerical values, but we can do long division with polynomials. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take the larger polynomial, which we even keep the same terminology. This is still called the dividend, if you remember back, many years ago. And x minus 1, the little guy you're dividing into the dividend, is called the divisor. Okay, so we're going to set those up the same way that we would like a numerical long division problem. And the only thing I'll say about the setup before we actually get into the math is this term right here. I intentionally left out a term in this example. When you're writing the dividend underneath the fraction bar, you have to have the highest degree x and every or lower order term down to the constants. So in this case, you have an x cubed, you have an x squared, you're missing x terms, and then you have a 5. So what that means is when you write this underneath the long division, you need to leave a 0x because there's not any x's, but I need to see that x slot. And the reason for that is eventually we're going to get columns that have x cubes, columns that have x squareds, columns with x's and constants. That's very important. That's not a I suggest to you do this, something like that. If you don't do that, you pretty much can't work the problem out. So it's very important. The divisor, if you're missing terms there, that doesn't matter. It's the dividend where you need the placeholders. So you play the same game that you did in middle school. You ask yourself, what times this polynomial will get me as close to this first few terms as possible. Now, to make this easier, you really only have to keep your eye on the leading term. Let's play the game this way. We'll say what times x will give me x cubed? Obviously, x squared. So we'll put an x squared up here. And then, just like with numbers, we'll take this times these two terms and write the product down here. X squared times x is x cubed. And x squared times negative 1 is minus x squared. And you can already kind of start to see we're going to get columns of individual terms here. That's why we have to have all those placeholders. It's also important that you write this very carefully and don't be sloppy with your work. Don't just slap down an x squared back here, but make sure to put it in the appropriate place. All right, next we subtract, as we can probably guess. Now, the thing to keep in mind is we actually have two columns we have to be subtracting. So let's be careful. X cubed minus x cubed cancels, it goes away. And be very careful with your signs with this next one. Negative 2x squared minus negative x squared. Now, when you have minus a negative, it makes a plus. So I think this would give us a negative x squared. So be careful with that. Don't put negative 3x squared or something incorrect like that. You're not adding these, you're subtracting these. Next up, bring down your placeholder. So you could say plus, 0x's, or you could just go ahead and drop down the 5 if you wanted to. I'm just going to go ahead and bring down the 0x's. We'll say what times x gives you negative x squared? We'll play the same game. So the answer would be negative x. Negative x times x is minus x squared. And then minus x times negative 1 makes plus x. Draw your line and subtract. Be careful with your signs. That's 0. 0 minus 1 makes minus 1x. Bring down that 5, just like if these were numerical values. What times x gives you negative x? Obviously, negative 1. This will give you negative x plus 1. Subtract, and you get 4. Okay. Now, again, keeping with the same terminology, this is called the quotient. And I hope you can see this behind my picture in picture. Let me scroll up. This is what we got right here, this 4. This is the one everybody remembers from, middle school whenever I teach this in class. This one's called the remainder. All right, now, what does this mean? What did this just help us do? Well, let me give you a quick numbers analogy and we'll see what we do next. If I asked you to take, 11 divided by 2, you do long division, 11 divided by 2, you get 5, 2 times 5 is 10, and a remainder of 1. What's the connection between this fraction and doing long division this way? Well, this says that 11 divided by 2, the meat of your answer, the majority of this answer, 11 over 2, is basically 5. And sure enough, 11 over 2 is around 5. Now, what do we do with this remainder? Can I just say it's 5 plus the remainder? Right? Well, we know that's not right because 11 over 2 is not 6. Here's what we need to know. It's a portion of the divisor. 1 is a remainder out of 2. And sure enough, 11 halves is 5.5. That is 5 and a half. So what I'm going to do is, ha instead of having this ugly quotient, this big ugly quotient, we can write that. Here's the point of long division. We can write this as basically the quotient, right here, the x squared minus x minus 1. X squared minus x minus 1. That's 95% of our answer right there. Now, instead of integrating this big ugly fraction, I would much rather integrate something like this. Now, there is the remainder. There's a remainder of 4 down here. But what do I do with the 4? Do I just say plus 4? No, not exactly. It's 4 out of x minus 1, just like my numbers example. Right? Now, if you go through term by term, this original guy, I have no idea how to integrate. He's too big, he's too ugly, wasn't use substitution, wasn't log rule. But if I go term by term, x squared I can integrate, x I can integrate, 1 I can integrate, and 4 over x minus 1 is easy to integrate. So doing long division gives you individual terms that that we can easily integrate. So final answer, we'll just do this super fast. Integral of x squared is x cubed over 3. It's the power rule. Minus x squared over 2, that's the power rule, minus x. And then this is a log integral. I'm not going to write out all the details, but this, if you had just an integral here, if you broke it up into individual integrals, the 4 could come out, and the integral of 1 over x minus 1 is the natural log of the absolute value of x minus 1. If you're not familiar with the log integrals, right, this log rule right here. You can watch one of my videos specifically on the log rule. So, hope that helps you understand how to integrate expressions like this. They stick out like a sore thumb on homework and test problems. It's whenever this degree is larger than this degree and you have two polynomials, you'll need long division.